hope that helps. Okay, let me start with the second presentation, which is, will be a bit shorter. So about our Copernicus work. Do you see other presentation?
I can see the.
Okay.
I can see
if the slides would move. Okay. So Copernicus is the European Union Earth Observation Program, looking at our planet and environment for the ultimate benefit of all European citizens. The program is coordinated and managed by European Commission, and it is implemented in partnership with member states, ESA, EUMETSAT, ECMWF, other EU agencies. And two of these services, which are Copernicus Atmospheric Monitoring Services and Copernicus Climate Change Services, are managed at ECMWF. In this, the rest of my tutorial, I will first give you a brief introduction to CDS and what data you can expect to find there and how to find it. Next, we will go through a couple of examples of using CDS API to get the data. And in the last part, we will do a little exercise of how to use and process the data in order to prepare it for example, your downstream applications or for some other analysis. In the first part, I will explain the sources of the data in CDS, and then I'll show you the data sets available and how to download them using web download capability, as well as CDS API and ADS API. So the European Commission has entrusted ECMWF with the implementation of Copernicus Climate Change Service. Copernicus Climate Change Service is providing information to increase the knowledge base to support adaptation and mitigation policies. The climate data store is the heart of C3S infrastructure and provides information about past, present, and future climate in terms of essential climate variables and derived climate indices. CDS offers free and open access to climate data and tools. CDS is designed as a distributed system, providing improved access to existing datasets through a unified web interface. So what does this mean? It means that the data you can download from CDS, and this also means for the ADS, Atmospheric Data Store, comes from many providers, not just ECMWF, but the data, all the data shares a unique web interface and the unique web, unique API. The CDS contains observations, global and regional climate reanalysis, global and regional climate projections, and seasonal forecasts. CDS provides an authoritative set of software, which we call a toolbox, that will allow the users to develop applications that will make use of the content of CDS. So which in practice means that you can, users can process the data on CDS toolbox prior to downloading it in order to reduce the size of the data. So what are the sources of the data in CDS? We have in situ observations, which are typically made of the weather stations at the weather stations or using weather balloons at many locations around the world. Then we have satellite or radar observations, which observe weather indirectly, and we always need more or less complex algorithms to translate radiation properties into weather variables. Then we have weather models that can be used for two purposes. First, to make analysis of the weather, injecting all observations available at a certain moment, and to obtain the best possible complete and consistent picture of the state of the atmosphere. We call this an analysis. Or when redone with the latest model version of on historical data, a reanalysis. Once we have the analysis, we can use it as initial state to start the weather forecast for a couple of days or weeks into the future. In weather models, we simply simplify or completely leave out certain processes and earth components that do not change on the time scale of a few days or a few weeks, for example, ocean or glacier related processes and states. However, climate models do include such processes explicitly, and they can be used to make a longer forecast up to months or a few years into the future. Next, the most comprehensive climate models that include, for example, also vegetation and ice cap development can make projections in many decades and centuries into the future. All of these can be found in CDS, except in situ observations and weather model forecasts for medium and extended range. There is a relationship between various data sources. Observations are needed for two things. First, to define the state of the atmosphere for a certain moment from where we start the model. And then observations are used for model development. The models are constantly validated against observations and improved where needed. Finally, each of these data sources can be transformed into sectoral relevant information computing statistical sectoral climate indices or assessing sector effects of weather and climate using what we call sectoral impact models. Now, just a little bit about each of the sources. First, we have the observations. We can roughly divide them into in-situ and remote observations. In-situ observations are measuring properties of the air and the ocean directly. Think of the thermometer that can be placed on the weather stations or in a balloon or a ship or a buoy in the ocean. Instrumental records of weather observations are available since mid-19th century, and the density of measurements and geographical spread is not even around the world, as you can see on this lower image. We have then satellite observations, which are available since 1970s. They often have coverage everywhere at the same resolution and density of measurements. However, satellites can sometimes make a picture of the Earth every few minutes, like geostationary satellites, but other, like polar orbiting satellites, only pass over certain locations once or twice a day or even every 10 days or so. Because they are lower and have much better resolution than geostationary satellites, which are very far away, it's like 36,000 kilometers above the Earth's surface. For many applications, single weather station or single satellite image are not very useful, and you will not find those in CDS, but at organizations that collect them. In order to facilitate against the weather and climate models, such data have been merged into regularly gridded products. And these are actually satellite observations that you can find in climate data store. So these were observations. And next on the CDS is a group of data sets produced by models that in terms of complexity and simulation strategies are attuned to be operated for a particular time horizons. All of these can be turned into, to be used to force the impact of model for a particular societal sector. So let's have a brief look of each of these model-derived data set. First, we already mentioned reanalysis. Reanalysis data remains closest to the observations, but we have the advantage that they are available for basically any location and any, almost any altitude in the any moment in time. So they are practically continuous in both space and time. As such, they often can be a good alternative to observations, especially in the regions over the world where the observation network is very sparse. They are a much better alternative than observations interpolated with some statistical technique. On CDS, you will find the latest global reanalysis data produced by ECNWF, which is ERA 5, and specialized higher resolution versions close to surface over land, which is ERA 5 land, and also European regional reanalysis produced by regional models. To facilitate many climate applications, we have also pre-calculated monthly mean averages, and those can be found in climate data store as well. Then we have climate projections. Even though ECNWF doesn't produce climate forecast, we do store them from the other producers in the climate data store. Like the other model data, they are produced on a sub-daily timescales. Climate projections have not been initialized, and as a result, are meaningful only in statistical sense. Even the historical runs in this group should not be compared day by day to the observations. They are meant to assess the change between historic and future climate. On CDS, you will find many climate projections from many models and climate centers. Currently available are global projections produced in fifth and sixth assessment report for the IPCC, which are CIMIP 6 and 5, and the regional climate projections for Europe produced in context of Cortex. Then we have sectorial impact data. At the moment, it's only water quality indicators for Europe is present in CDS, but we are working on adding many more models. Then we have another Copernicus service at ECMWF, which is Copernicus Atmospheric Monitoring Service, COMS. The same as C3S has climate data store, COMS has atmospheric data store, which stores past, present, and future information related to air pollution and health, solar energy, greenhouse gases, and climate forcings. Since COMS became operational in 2015, anybody has been able to find and read about atmospheric composition data via COMS data catalog, but users have been redirected to distributed data portals to download them. Now, the data in the catalog has been systematically moved over to the atmospheric data store, where they can be downloaded all in one place and one format that is easier to use for the users. ADS became operational in June last year, and the process of moving the data sets from the catalog to ADS is very much ongoing. The data sets available in ADS cover global reanalysis of atmospheric composition, greenhouse gas fluxes, solar radiation services, European regional air quality forecast, and as of very recently, global atmospheric composition forecasts. So how do you find the data? Well, as you can see, there's a lot of data. So if you just think, oh, I need just the temperature data, precipitation data, that will not get you far. You need to know the time horizon, the region. You need to know if you need observations or you need model data. Do you need model data as reanalysis, or you need seasonal data, or you want to know the climate projection for the next 50 years? So when you know these things, you will know how to find the data. More specific you are, more will narrow the catalog. So here are links to the climate data store and atmospheric data store. And I will try to post them in the chat, but I hope you all have them. I put them in the editor thingy because I wanted to show how and what you can do on them. Before that, if anybody has any questions, and I saw that something is in chat.
There is a question in the chat, Milana.
Yes, what is climate forcing? Now you got me because I'm not a climate expert. I can get back to you exactly because I don't want to say something stupid here. Okay. Let me now open CDS. Okay. So you can find link to CDS in the HackMD at the beginning. I put the link. So how does it work? So when you go to the first page, you have a couple of things that you can explore, but most common one that you came here to get the data, so you come and see the data sets. There's a lot of data sets here. So how do you narrow it down? So you have this menu on the left, so where you can choose, oh, do I want some climate data, or I want tree analysis or satellite observations. For example, if we click satellite observations, we will only get here now what satellite observations are available. If we go to seasonal forecast, it will show us which seasonal forecast data sets are available. We can then go and narrow it more if we want the European seasonal forecast. Well, there's only this flood European forecast, but if we want global, there's many more. So for example, let's say that we want reanalysis. Well, there are many reanalysis products. It's not just ERA5. There are many other indices that are calculated from, for example, from ERA5, such as these fire indices and thermal comfort indices as well. So let's say that we want our ERA5. So as you can see, ERA5 is available hourly, and then some monthly statistics are calculated. Let's say that we want ERA5 hourly on single, ERA5 hourly on single levels. Here we have an overview of the data set. This is the same for each data set in the data store, and it is the same in the atmospheric data store. So it's exactly, they are copies of each other, I mean, clones. So for each data set, there is this overview. And then we have the parts about downloading the data, documentation, and quality assessment. In the part where the downloading the data is, we can actually use the, if you just want to explore the data to see if this really is the data that we want to use, we can use the web interface. So for each of this section, at least one thing has to be selected. And if we select something here, parameter, year, month, time, and we can choose if we want the whole globe, or we want to some region. So if we are in Europe and want only Europe data, we can narrow the area down, and then it will also reduce the size of data significantly. We can in the end choose, do we want the GRIB or NetCDF data? Most people are used to working with NetCDF and find working with GRIB adventurous. So, and we want in NetCDF. It is experimental in a sense that not all the combinations of these parameters will work. For example, if you choose more of these product types, the request will fail. It can only have one type. So that's one of the limitations that I know. In the end, you will see the part about the license. And if you open the, if you followed, if you go to the Climate Data Store catalog and go to this data, if you plan to use the, to work on the interactive part where we'll get the data, you should come and accept the Copernicus license, because if you try to run the API later, it will won't work first time. It will tell you, oh, please go to the CDS and accept the license. I already did this, so that is why it's here. I don't have the thingy. So this is very useful when you start working in this, because you can actually see the API, what the API request looks like. So you can use this to build the skeleton, and then afterwards you can edit this and add more parameters or time steps in your script, whatever. So if we go here, we will see that it automatically adds parameters here. So from here, you can do two things. Either you can submit this request, or you can copy this in your Python script. If we submit the request, it will go to here to my requests, and I will see that my request is now queued. It might be that CDS is busy or whatever. I'm now waiting. And you can also see all your recent requests, and they are available for you for a couple of days after you actually made the request. And not only these from web, the requests also made with the API are available here. For example, these two that I don't have link. So these from web have link, and I can see what I chose here, and I can actually go to my request form. If I did the request using the API, I will see this request here. So this is also the place from which you can, if you forgot where your request is or something, you can copy it from here as well. So when this does not look nice that it's waiting for a minute, but okay. So when it's the queue is done, it will say processing, and then it will start getting your data. Here you can also see which of your requests are queued, if you have requests that are in progress, that failed, or that are complete. You can also see how busy actually the CDS is when it loads. So if you use it often, then you will see what numbers are, I mean, busy, because I don't use it so much. I don't really know what these numbers mean, but it looks like it's struggling to even give it something, but oh well. Okay.